That's been incredible, it really has. And I was lucky enough to be part of the jury for first directorial debut. And the standard of work in those 12 movies was absolutely mind-blowing. You know, I was really, really touched by so many of those movies. They are so much heart, but also the professional way that they finish these pieces of work was absolutely brilliant. And it was a very tough decision when we sat in that room. It was a good couple of hours deliberation trying to decide which was going to win. I think what the BFI does and the London Film Festival does is it's not just the big movies that already get all the attention. What it does is it brings world cinema to your doorstep, and it also really does champion the independent filmmaker. And that's why I was delighted to have the invitation game here last year as the opening movie, and then also to be here as one of the jury makers. It just shows, you know, how important it is to give these movies the opportunity to be seen and to be spoken about, and that's why I was so passionate about being part of the jury.
Talking about beloved British institutions, obviously fans were very sad to hear that this is going to be our final season of Downton. As someone who's been such a huge part of that show, what does it mean for you to have that drawing to a close?
I feel it's the right thing to do, and I think we all felt a tinge of sadness, but also a sense that we were ending it in the right way and happy to have been part of what has been the most amazing journey over the last 6 years, with something that we started as, you know, seven episodes, not knowing where it was going to go, and then to be where it is now is really something very special, and something that I will always look back with very fondly. But, you know, at the end of the day, these things have to come to an end, and it's much better that we do it now rather than turn into, you know, past the summer wine. Not that that wasn't a great show. Yeah.
Fans have already been speculating that we might either get a spin-off series set in New York or potentially a big screen adaptation. Do you think that Downton would work on the big screen, and would that be something that would interest you as a project?
I think it would interest us if the right script was there. You know, the one thing that even Julian Fellowes has always said is, you know, I'd have to find a standalone story, because it would have to, you know, be there maybe for 2 hours. And if he comes up, he has a couple of ideas, and if he comes up with that and we all read the script and we like it, and then it's just trying to get 22 people back in a room at the same time, which good luck to that. I hope they get on well with that.
You've already said it was a very special experience for you. I'm curious though, looking back now with a little bit of distance, is there one memory that stands out absolutely as your fondest, the one that makes you smile the biggest every time you think of it?
I think, to be honest, could I pick one? It'd be very difficult. I really don't think I could. There's been so many incredible opportunities, but I don't know. We'll have to see what. I think some of them actually might come in the end of this series, and by the time people watch it, some of the scenes that I've got to do with Michelle Dockery, you know, someone that I've really always enjoyed working with, and I can't really pick one. I can't do it. I wish I could. Winning the SAG Award for the first time, you know. I actually genuinely thought they'd read out the wrong name because I was like Breaking Bad. I wanted to apologise as we went by. I just did a movie called Hunter's Prayer, so that's the next thing coming out with Sam Worthington. Apart from that, I'm looking at some scripts. I want to make sure the next thing I do is, you know, up to the standard of the work that I've been lucky enough to be part of, and I'm not going to rush into anything, and I'm lucky enough not to have to.
Tell us anything about that project with Sam.
It's a thriller. It's set around a hitman and his conscience. That's Sam, who Sam plays, and lucky enough I got to play a bad guy, which is something that I haven't done in a long time, and I revelled in it. I really enjoyed doing something so different, and in the modern day, it was nice not to have to wear a stiff collar again.
Is that something you're actively looking to do, to kind of distance yourself from the nice guy image?
No, it's always about the work, you know. It's not really about picking a certain role just to do that, or to differentiate myself from another role that I played. I always look at the work, I look at the job, and see if it's something that I'm interested in doing. I never really look at it as you know, a worry of being typecast, no.
Do you have a message for, I guess, particularly Downton fans all around the world who have loved your work and are very much enjoying our final Downton Swans?
I'd have to say thank you very much for watching, because without you guys, the show would be nothing. And I hope that you're happy with the way it ends.
You know, as an English girl, and, you know, all the cast being from England, it's just such an honour. And it's so nice to be back here. It's been far too long.
People who haven't been fortunate enough to see The Witch, can you give us a quick synopsis and tell us what excited you about the project?
Well, I guess what excited me was that it read like anything that I've read before. It was so unique. And it's a story of a Puritan family that goes off into the woods, and bad stuff goes down, I guess is the only way I can say it. I love these people so much. So you've got Ralph Ineson, Kate Dickey, Harvey Scrimshaw. The kids are there as well. And then obviously it's Robert Eggers directing, and Jaron Blaschke doing the cinematography, and he's great. He's so talented. you can be sure that the second that you walk in, that you're going to be very uncomfortable, you know, the entire time. And that's really aided by the score that was done by Mark Corvin and all of Jaren's cinematography. You know, he really takes his time with, like, the dolly and everything like that. So, yeah.
What else are you working on at the moment? What's coming up next for you?
I'm about to start shooting this movie by, being directed by M. Night Shyamalan. So I'm off on Tuesday, which is exciting.
Obviously, he's an astonishing director. Can you tell us anything about that project, who you're playing, what it's generally about?
Oh, I can't. You know what it's like. Sign all of your life away. But I'm excited to do it.
Incredibly special, and we're absolutely honoured to have been selected and for the film to be part of the Southern London Award as well. It's the first time that, you know, an Ethiopian film of this calibre is coming to the festival, so we're really honoured, yes. It's an important story. One is an Ethiopian story, and there are very few Ethiopian stories. And this story tells it's a story about a young boy who loses his mother to famine, and he becomes attached to a lamb that belonged to the mother. And he's sent to live with distant relatives, and in this new context, he's told that he has to sacrifice his lamb, and he does everything to save the lamb and return home. And why it's important, I think, particularly in the UK context, because, you know, we're used to certain images of Ethiopia, but this is an Ethiopian film written and directed by an Ethiopian, and so it shows an aspect of Ethiopia that we don't know, particularly in the UK.
What are you hoping international audiences specifically take away from the experience of the film?
It's a universal story. So it's actually something that everybody can watch. It's not just Ethiopians who are going to enjoy it. You know, at the basis, it's about a boy and his animal. It could have been a boy with his dog or something like this. So, you know, and it's also about someone who's dealing with loss. And so these are all very, very universal stories. And that's why the story is also done really well, because, you know, a lot of people can identify with it. So it's released in France right now, and it's going to be in Germany, Switzerland, and lots of different countries. And we hope that we're going to get UK distribution to actually show it to a wider audience.
It's about a woman coming home for a family reunion with a family she hasn't seen in a very long time, and things go downhill. And hopefully it sounds like a movie you've seen before, but it's not. Or at least that's the goal. And it's very personal to my family's experience, and I made it literally with my family. And like my aunt who's over there stars in the movie, and yes. I think it adds a level of authenticity that you can't fake and refabricate. My grandma's also in the movie. She didn't know we were making a movie, so I don't know. I think it's interesting when people see the movie after not knowing what it's about and talking to them. And a lot of stuff, yeah, they don't know they're literally family members. They think they're just great actors, but I like to think that there's a subconscious effect and some kind of authenticity that comes through that can't be faked. Addiction, regret, family, family lineage, there's a lot going on, hopefully different people can take different things. But at the core, it's a study of this character, and hopefully all these themes come out of that.
What does it mean for you to be part of the London Film Festival?
It's fantastic. Humbled. Lovely to be here. There's fantastic movies here, so I'm just very humbled and grateful. I couldn't have made this movie a couple years ago. I could have made it, but not in the way the final movie is. The goal with this movie was always to be really ambitious with the resources we had. And even though it's a small movie made at my mom's house with family members, I wanted it to feel like a big movie and feel cinematic. And the only way I could do that is with the tools of today. As far as distribution, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure like being able to just screen a movie on a DCP and everything makes it easier, but yeah, distribution's still tricky. I picked up a camera when I was a little kid, and it just felt right, and I think I've always just been obsessed with it, and that's all I want to do.
What are you doing next?
My American distributor in the States, A24, is releasing this movie and funding and releasing my next movie, which is sort of my version of a horror film. But hopefully by the end you are terrified and crying. It's very it's an emotional, personal movie, and it's not a normal horror movie, but it's exciting.
I'm looking for originality. When I'm looking at first features, I want to see someone with a voice and something to say, that there's a reason they're communicating through the medium of film. You know, it actually is, I find it immoral to take up people's time for 2 hours to sit there and watch something unless you are doing something different. And so many films you watch, you feel like you're getting the same narrative in different costumes and different time periods. So that was what was exciting in this go around, is to watch these films and to really let them speak to you. And the film that ended up taking the award, it touched me, it really shocked me and had something really original to say. And that was exciting. There is a film called The Hereafter that's a British film, and it really took my breath away. It was a cast of non-actors, of children, and the performances were so heartfelt and honest. And I watched throughout the entire film. I kept wondering, how did this woman talk to her cast? Like, how did she get them to behave so naturally on camera, especially with children? That film broke my heart a little, and I really enjoyed it.
What do you think the value is of nights like tonight, particularly for supporting that next generation of filmmakers?
I think there's a lot to be said about paying attention to first feature filmmakers and giving them a platform and saying, this is a voice to listen to. For the most part, these weren't very commercial films. You know, one of them was, I think, the first film to come out of Ethiopia, maybe ever. So it's important to shine a light on these films and also say to these directors that, though, I mean, at this stage in the game, I know as someone who's only made one feature that it's not a financially viable lifestyle. But when you do get awards and when you do get this kind of attention, you're able to build a career in a way that you otherwise wouldn't be able to. So I'm very proud to be a part of that. I mean, the London Film Festival, I dare you to find someone who cannot find a film that speaks to them here. It is such a wide array of movies, the best coming around Europe. But it's also quite diverse. It's not, usually film festivals have one point of view, particularly, and with LFF, it seems as though they have something for everyone. And I really appreciate that about this festival, that there's a laugh section, there's drama, there's romance, there's everything. So you can always find your home here.
Can you tell us a little bit about the unique piece of cinema that you've contributed to this year's festival?
It's the first feature film out of Vanuatu, actually, that was made with people who are non-actors, who had never actually seen a feature film before we started working together. And here we are in one of the best film festivals of the world, celebrating its British premiere.
Why do you feel it's so important to give a cinematic voice to people from anywhere in the world?
Because it's just plain interesting, entertaining, and you learn something too. This is a place that has not just a lot to teach us, but it's entering another world that we're not familiar with. You know, one of volcanoes, one where, you know, spirits are real, and people just look dead gorgeous. Look, it was a pleasure from beginning to end, living there for 7 months with my family. We ate together, learnt about each other. Look, the filming conditions were terrible. I had to actually spend a lot of time on tropical beaches, you know, in between takes, going for a swim amongst the coral, you know, that sort of thing. Horrible, horrible.
Well, I feel so great to be here. It's quite a strange experience which I'm up to for the first time in the history of my life. So I feel so great to be in it, and I feel so honored, and I'm so glad to be here, so proud. Well, the story of the film is, it's all about Tana, the real life of Tana, the way we live, and it's all about the power of love. That transformative power of love. It's been a great achievement for the people, not just for the local people, but for the whole country of Vanuatu.
It's a big honor just to be in the festival, as you said it, but also we are in the official competition. And there's a section for first feature films, and we are a first feature film. So it's already a big honor to be lined up with these big names in today's cinema. And being here, bringing the film here for its European premiere is like having a wider reach, wider than what we already expected. So I hope everybody enjoyed the film, we enjoyed the city and the festival.
It's a great honor to be here. It's a great honor to be nominated for this award. So actually, we're just very happy to be here.
This is enough. It's being an official competition in London for our first feature film. It's quite enough for us. We are here just to enjoy our time, have drinks with the guys.
So this is our second festival. So we premiered in Toronto, and this is the second one. London is charismatic. It's a different place to be. The festival is more innovative, but I mean, London, Toronto is bigger, but it's great to be here, and London was a great opportunity for us.
I cannot really compare. Each festival is different. Each is in a different city. Toronto and London are not the same. In Toronto, it was the world premiere. We gained a lot from this world premiere in terms of future partners, of exposure. And now here in London, it feels like we're a bit closer to an audience that looks like the film itself.
It deals with drug dealings in Beirut. It's about three brothers that work together to find the maximum out of the relationship and from their business.
First of all, anyone watching the film would be like giving us time and space to hear our voices. So I guess I just want to translate the concept that we've been working on throughout the film, translate some of the feelings that we have, talk about the region where we come from, and celebrate cinema.
I just fell in love with the story. I read Mary Mapes' book that it's the story is based on. Mary Mapes was a producer for 60 Minutes 2 at CBS. And in 2004, she and Dan Rather, who she worked for, who was the sitting anchor at CBS News, took on a story about then-President George W. Bush at the height of the presidential election. And the story they got onto was the possibility that George W. Bush had gotten into the National Guard through family connections so he didn't have to go through Vietnam. And this story was incredibly dramatic stakes to it, and they ran it, and it ended up sort of exploding in their face. And so I loved the idea of taking audiences behind the scenes of how broadcast journalism is done, and then taking them through how this story came together and fell apart.
It's a big story. It's a big cast as well. Can you talk particularly, I guess, about working with Cate and Robert Redford?
Sure. I mean, look, Cate Blanchett is the actor of her generation, and Robert's the actor of his generation. So the idea of just having them on screen together was incredibly exciting. I was so gratified that they said yes. And the wonderful thing, too, is what fans they are of each other and how badly they wanted to work together. And I got to tell you, the first day they were both on set together, it was about 3 weeks into our shoot, and watching them do that first scene together, and you could just see them kind of ping off each other, and I felt like we really had something special.
Talking about something special, fans, of course, are delighted to be going back into the world of Independence Day after 20 years. Can you talk about what we can expect from that and how much fun you've had playing in that sandbox?
I love the original Independence Day, and I was lucky enough that Roland Emmerich and Dean Devlin asked me to come and sort of play with them a little bit and work on the script a little bit. They'd already written an amazing version of it, and I just kind of came in and pitched in and tried to help out. But I think that, you know, and I don't want to ruin anything, I think that you know, Roland has invented this genre that now we see so many of, and I think he's looking to close it out and do the best one he's that's ever been done. And I, for one, just as a film goer, I'm so excited to see what he does with it.
An incredibly prestigious award, you know, an award that's been accepted in the past by Judi Dench and, you know, Al Pacino and Robert Altman and Ridley Scott. I mean, it's an incredible honour indeed. I've been so influenced by films that have come out of the UK and have enjoyed making films here every single time I have. And in fact, kind of, I suppose you could say my biggest break, you know, playing Queen Elizabeth happened here with working titles. So I'm so thrilled, really thrilled.
Okay, we're especially thrilled to be enjoying Truth tonight. Can you tell us a little bit about the extraordinary story behind that and why you feel it's so important to dramatise such recent history?
Well, it's about a very particular media scandal that happened in 2004 in America, but I think it's got a greater sort of, the story's got a greater universal appeal in that it talks really about how investigative journalists put stories together, and is there the time to do that with a 24-hour news cycle? And also the proximity, it talks about the proximity of our politicians to our media organisations, which I think goes kind of undiagnosed and unprocessed.
Can I ask about working with Robert Redford and obviously bringing Dan Rather to the big screen as well?
Well, Bob Redford is one of the most influential figures in world cinema. You know, he's... he's directed and starred in some of the you know the greatest films of all time. So to work with him as was a singular privilege, and no one else could have played the role of Dan Rather, because both are incredibly iconic. So we're so grateful that he said yes.